Let's continue with visualization and analysis and design and talk more about marks and channels. So we had this idea that there's a lot of different channels, and I said that we had some idea of the effectiveness of these channels, but how do we know? So there's actually been quite a lot of research that has led us to some conclusions, and we think about channels in at least four different ways. One is accuracy. How precisely could we tell the difference between items that have been encoded with a particular channel? Can people succeed in decoding accurately? Another is discriminability. How many unique steps can we see with the channel? And of course, does this match up with the number of levels in an attribute? How separable are they? Does one channel step on the toes of another channel? The answer, sadly, often is yes. And then pop out, can things actually jump out at us without the need for conscious attention using this channel? So let's go through these four. So with accuracy, there have been many decades of psychophysical experiments where psychophysics is the study of how to measure perceptual phenomena. And what S.S. Stevens came up with after decades of work is this idea that there is a psychophysical power law, that the sensation that humans have has some power law relationship to the intensity of the stimulus. And so basically the exponent changes according to what kind of thing is getting perceived. Notice how in this diagram here, length is an exponent of one. That is, we are able to very, very accurately perceive length. In contrast with a lot of these other sensory modalities, there's either a magnification or a compression. And so the exponent here actually characterizes, first of all, which direction, magnify or compress, and by how much compared to something that was fully accurate. So we'll notice that we see things like area and three-dimensional depth into the scene and brightness as examples of compression. And then there's some magnification for things like saturation, right? A giant thing of color compared to a small thing of color. Even electric shock, although that's not as brutal as it seems, it's more of a tingling in the fingertips. They actually did these studies on many, many kinds of modalities. I'm not gonna get into the ones about things like weight and smell and all that. We're gonna focus on the visual in the rest of this. So those are psychophysical experiments about channels in general. And then people have also done experiments, particularly Cleveland and McGill in the early 80s, which have been replicated by others. Including Jeff Herr and Mike Bostock more recently, about actually having people look at charts and trying to figure out, okay, can you decode the information that was encoded here? And so in these, they're focused specifically on error rates, like how often do people get a perceptual judgment right versus wrong? And we can see here that these charts involving seeing spatial position had fewer errors than when people are trying to make judgments about angles or about areas. And so that's another way to actually try to see, how do these different channels actually play out in the context of visualization charts, not just abstractly in general. So another thing we can think about is how many usable steps are there in a channel? So we have to match that with the number of attribute levels that we want to show, right? Here's an example with line width. And the thing that's interesting about line width is you can't make a line sort of arbitrarily fat because at some point it won't seem like a line anymore. It'll seem much more like an area, right? So there's sort of some limits on the number of levels that you could encode with line width. That's not saying line width is bad. It's not saying we always want the max number of levels. We're saying we have to make sure it's a match. If you have a relatively small number of levels in your categorical attribute, then line width might be completely reasonable, as we see here in this map showing telecommunications traffic between different European countries. Now, another factor we have to consider is, do my channels step on each other's toes? That is, are they perceived separably or are they automatically integrated by our perceptual system? So let's start with a nice case where they're fully separable. Position, spatial position on the display versus color. So what I'm going to tell you I've done in this slide is we've got two different ways of separating these marks into two groups. Spatial position, right, the left side and the right side, and color. We have the blue things and the orange things. This is fully separable. You can either attend to the sides or you can attend to the colors. And so you're able to read out the information about either one of these two attributes as you choose. Okay, what about this one? Now, here we've got size coding and color coding. And the thing is, it's really easy. For those big points, we can see purple versus blue. But as the points are small, it's actually a little bit harder to read that out. There is a known interaction between size and color. Our ability to perceive color depends on how large the thing we're looking at is. So there's some interference. We can still do this. It's not that it's impossible to read out the answer, but our ability to do it quickly and easily is impaired by doing this with things that are small size compared to large size. But we can still see there's two groups, right? Blue and purple, big and little. Well, what if we had the bright idea that we're going to encode something with width and with height separately? The thing is, you've encoded width and height, but what the people are decoding when they look at this is actually small things and big things and squished things, right? Whether they're squished vertically or squished horizontally, we're sort of, what we're doing is we're perceiving the area as an integral property of these. And it's much harder to see that 2x2 structure that we saw before, because really we're seeing three groups of things here. You know, maybe even four groups squished one way versus the other way, but it's not easy to see these two different things that we saw before. That problem where the big and the small and the intermediate one, that's our perception of area. And then finally, we've got this terrible case here where I can tell you that I have carefully taken two values for red and two values for green and encoded this here. And it's useless for me to tell you that, because what you see is you see four things, you see four colors. So our perceptual system has integrated these together into a perception of color. So people often assume that channels are fully separable when they are not. Sometimes we can make use of the integrality of channels on purpose, but you should always be aware of which ones are separable and which ones are integral, so that you don't assume that things are separable when in fact your perceptual system integrates them together, meaning that the use of one channel affects your ability to use another. Okay, let's talk about pop-out. Sometimes this is called pre-attentive processing, but this is a phenomenon that's not about you needing to pay attention. So let's try it out. You're going to do something simple. We're going to do it together since we're on video. We're going to find a red dot. And let's think about how long it takes. So I'm going to say go. And then as you're watching this, I literally want you to say out loud, got it, as soon as you see it. So let's try it. I'll be your proxy. 1, 2, 3, go. Got it? Okay, saw a red dot. Let's try it again. 1, 2, 3, go. Got it? Okay, that wasn't so hard. Let's try this again. Find the red dot. 1, 2, 3, go. Got it. Ah, but now it wasn't red versus blue. Now it was dots versus squares. Let's try that again. 1, 2, 3, go. Got it. Okay. One last round. So again, find the red dot. 1, 2, 3, go. Got it. Now I'm sneaky. I have red and blue dots and squares. The last one, 1, 2, 3, go. Got it. Okay, so that last one took me a lot longer. And it's interesting to note, well, why is this the case? So what was happening was, it was actually not so bad for me to find the red dot amongst the blue dots if I had few blue dots or lots of blue dots. The red dot popped out. And that was very true for the color coding. It was still true for the shape coding. I was a little slower, but I was still able to not have too much impairment. And that's because what our visual system is doing is it's really doing parallel processing. So roughly independent of the number of these distractor objects, I was able to find whether the target object I was looking for was there. my speed is going to depend on how different they are from each other. You know, red versus blue is really different, whereas, you know, filled in circles versus filled in squares are not that different from each other compared to, say, a really different shape. But when I combined the dots and the shapes and the colors, suddenly I got a lot slower when I added more distractors. And that's because we can no longer get this great sort of parallel processing. We have to actually start checking them one by one, what's called serial search. And then the speed really does depend on the number of distractors. So in general, there are very few counterexamples where maybe we could combine two, but for many combinations, we don't get that, and for all triplets and more. And so what that means is that although it would be tempting to think, oh, we could get pop out on any individual channel, once you start combining them, sometimes it's called conjunctive search, then we no longer can rely on pop out. Now I'll point out that pop out is not just about shapes and colors. It's a huge number of channels actually do allow pop out. So things like tilt and size and, you know, shape, proximity, even subtle things like shadow. So a lot of things as a single channel, our visual system will give us pop out. I note that it's not absolutely everything. For example, parallelism is not something we can get pop out from. We actually would have to do serial search to figure out if when we've got the tilt versus the parallel one. So it's not everything, although it's lots of things. So some of the factors that affect the accuracy of this pop out and of perception in general are, first of all, alignment. So, and sorry, this is not about pop out, this is just about accuracy. So alignment is a major, major factor. You might remember that in our list of channels, we had position along a common scale was even higher ranked than just position, 2D spatial position. And that's because we're much more able to accurately judge when things are aligned than when they're not. Also the number of distractors, as we just saw with our pop-out experiments. Also the distance between things. So why is this? Well, it's because the human visual system is all built around relative, not absolute judgments. So we're great at relative judgments, and we're surprisingly bad at absolute judgments, but most people aren't aware of that because our perceptual system is doing a lot of filling in things around the edges for us. So the reason that accuracy increases when we've got this common frame and when we've got alignment is that it changes the kind of relative judgments we can make. So let's look at this example here, where we've got the length of two bars. And on the left, it's actually not the easiest task to figure out which is longer because their lengths are actually relatively similar to each other. Now, this is actually generalized as Weber's law. Technically, the ratio of the increment to the background is constant. And what that means is that the more different things are, the easier it is for us to notice. So what's happening is when we have a common scale like we do in the middle here, something changed. The difference between the lengths of the blue bars is about 1 to 9, so that's hard. But when we've got that common scale, now instead of making a judgment about the blue bars, we can make a judgment about those white parts. And those white parts are different in length by about 1 to 2, and that's an easy judgment. So it's faster and easier to understand that one is larger than the other with that common scale. And then finally, we're incredibly good when we're aligned because we have a similar situation here where as soon as we take A and B and align their bottoms, suddenly the differences between their tops are really, really easy to make this perceptual judgment along. And that's why we are really going to talk a lot about spatial alignment within the display as being a very high precision, high accuracy decoding task. And this comes down to the fact that our perceptual system does do all these relative judgments. It's not just about spatial position, it's also about all aspects of color. For example, even just, you know, grayscale luminance. It's very contextual. This is a great optical illusion from Adelson's lab. And I'm gonna ask you a really dumb question. These two squares, the one marked A and the one marked B, it's a checkerboard, right? So are they different colors or are they the same color? Now, what we know about checkerboards is, of course, they're different colors. But if I actually put some stripes on here, we see this incredibly surprising fact that, in fact, those are the same color, but your eye interprets them differently on the left because you think that there's a shadow. And we've got all kinds of fantastic mechanics in our perceptual system so that shadows do not cause us to be unable to walk. But that mechanism, which is great for walking around in the real world, actually can often lead us astray when we are trying to encode information visually. So our judgments about color are made based on the surroundings of that color, which can make things quite tricky. For example, here's one where we can look at not just grayscale color, but other kinds of color and different kinds of lighting, like outdoor sunlight versus indoor artificial lights. We're able to still judge, you know, that red is red. But in fact, the photons coming to our eyes, the wavelengths we're seeing can be quite different. So here's an example where we seem to have the same thing, but we've got a yellow versus a purple shadow. And then if, again, I just mask out some things, I see that what appears to be red on both sides of that Rubik's Cube, in fact, are dramatically different colors. But we experience them as red on the left because our brain is just interpreting this as if we're looking through tinted lenses. And it's trying to say, oh no, both of those still count as red in this illumination context. So we're going to have to think a lot about that. We'll talk more in the color section about some of these phenomena. But what it comes down to from an accuracy point of view is be aware that because our perceptual system makes relative versus absolute judgments, that will have a strong impact on how we can decode data that's been encoded with a channel.